I was conceived by rape. There's no getting around it. She was raped.
It was born because of a crime.
Do I look like the man who raped my birth mother?
He said, "Mum, am I a rape baby?" And I said, "No, you're my baby."
No one wants to talk about what we're going through.
He was my angel.
We shouldn't have to hide it anymore.
I'm putting the one of the hardest stories about my life out there. And it's petrifying.
That was literally just minutes after I'd give birth to him. I just looked so young.
I were only 14 when I met a man called Arshad Hussain. He were 10 years older than me, and from that moment, he began grooming me. At the time, I didn't see it for what it was. I thought that's how love was supposed to be.
I was 15 when I got pregnant. God, I still remember him being in my arms. And I just had that moment, that instant bond that I think only a mother kind of, you know, feels. He's so chunky.
I was so excited to be a mum. But as I got older, I started to understand what had happened to me.
The abuse of young girls in Rotherham was deep-rooted and
meticulous. Arshad Hussain was the ringleader behind
rape
the grooming.
Rape after rape, assault after assault. He has now been jailed for 35 years.
Sammy Woodhouse gave birth to a son after she was raped.
I remember when those thoughts first started running through my head. I was panicking about my son. I thought, what am I going to tell my son? I couldn't see a light at the end of the tunnel.
My son were only 12 when I had to tell him that his dad had raped and abused me, and that's how we were born.
He didn't want to be the person who he was. He didn't want to be in his own skin. I blamed myself. I felt so stupid. My bruises healed. My mind didn't.
We both felt so alone, and there was nowhere for us to turn. There must be others out there feeling the same way.
I'm related to a murderer and also a rapist. And I used to think horrible things like, what if I grow up to be like him?
You feel grief, you feel anger, you feel shame.
I know there's nothing that I could have done, but it feels like it's my fault that I'm alive.
You're putting yourself in your birth mother's shoes. You're also thinking, am I going to remind her of the person who did this to her?
And I think it's incredible that she even decided to keep me. I don't think I could ever look at that child without thinking about all the abuse.
I just want acceptance and to know that I'm normal, despite where I've come from.
The worst feeling is feeling like you're alone. You're questioning everything about yourself. Do I look like a rapist? Looking in the mirror, almost like I could see the man who raped my mother looking back at me. You grow up with all these ideas of who you are. You're kind and you're nice and you're loving. And then you find out you were conceived in a really violent, almost hateful way.
It pulls the heart out of your world.
Neil grew up adopted and Tracy's birth mother when he was 27.
Hi, Sammy.
Is it Neil? Yeah.
It was then that he discovered he was born after she was raped by a stranger in a park.
When you hear those words, it's like somebody's almost like a video game punched into your chest and ripped your inside out.
Yeah.
I just broke down completely and utterly lost it. So I did meet with my birth mother, and one of the first things I said to her was, if I look like the man who did this to you, walk away. I don't want to bring that back.
Yeah, and upset her. And what did she say?
She said, it's fine, you don't look like him. That really changed things for me.
Yeah.
It really, really did.
Have you ever wanted to meet him just to confront him and say, why did you do this?
The man who did that to my birth mother is just nothing to me. Mm. For, you know, I can't be clear enough about this, that how angry I was at him.
Yeah.
But no, I wouldn't want anything to do with him. To all intents and purposes, I don't think of myself as having a birth father.
Yeah.
I have my birth mother and that's it.
Yeah.
And that's enough.
For me, what's kind of hard to sit here and listen to is that you had all this to deal with and it's affected you so much. And you as an adult dealing with this, you was like in your 20s. My son was 12 years old. With no one to talk to. So I'm kind of just sat here thinking, I feel in a way like I've failed him.
I don't think you have at all. I think by being open and honest, you've done the best by him. So long as there is love there and you can show that love and explain that how he was conceived is the most unimportant thing in the world. It's, you are my son. You know, I love you beyond anything. You're part of me, and that's the important thing. Mm. And we might have to work at it more every day than most families because we're both hurting.
Mm.
But we're together, and that's the important thing, and you're my son.
I've tried so hard to be the best mum I can to my son. But no matter how much I love him, he still has his shadow hanging over him. And I know he has questions about his dad, but I don't know whether the reality would really help him.
I'd love to know where he's buried so I could go and dance on his grave. This monstrous man that felt that he could do that, and that it was okay to do that, and that it was okay to rape people. I think there's a special place in hell for people like that.
It's a reality that Eva confronted. She grew up adopted, imagining a perfect family she'd one day find. But when she met her birth mother, the truth was much darker.
She had been abused from a young age by her father, and she had got pregnant at the age of 14. I was the result of that liaison. It made me feel unwanted, a freak, but I still wanted to know more. So I rang him and I asked him if he'd done the things that he'd been accused of. And he said, yes, he had. And I said to him, do you feel remorse for what you did? And he said, no, I don't. And I said, would you do it again? He said, yes, I would. I wanted him to pay for what he'd done. And the only way that I could see for that to happen was to go to the police. They said they needed evidence. And I said, well, you've got the evidence standing right in front of you. I'm living, breathing proof of the evidence. that this man raped someone. They didn't seem to care. They didn't seem interested. I'm glad I found out where I came from. I needed to know.
What was that driving force to find those missing pieces?
I think it doesn't matter how horrible the past is, it's like an itch that you can't scratch.
Yeah.
And you've just got to know. Mm. You've got to know.
It helps to know I did the right thing telling my son the truth. But meeting Neil and Ava has made me realise we're not the only ones going through this alone. And I know I buried a lot of my own feelings because they're just too painful to deal with. There must be other mums out there feeling the same way.
It's like if you inject poison into somebody. It's exactly what happened to me. My father injected our own genes into me.
He told me that all daddies did this to their little girls. And then I fell pregnant.
It wasn't, you know, just about the rape and the physical abuse. It was the emotional abuse.
I really wanted to tell what was happening. And I couldn't tell a soul, I couldn't tell anybody what had happened just that day, what I'd been through.
Well, I didn't have time to have any thoughts. It was your having this child, simple as. This child's going to call me daddy as well. I just felt sick. Just, no. What am I going to do?
I felt like I was just so different to everybody else, and I felt so alone. And, you know, I was embarrassed and ashamed of myself as a person. So...
If he'd made me have that baby, I don't think I'd have survived. I wouldn't be here today.
I had to survive. I had to survive to leave.
The next train to arrive at platform one.
I packed some nappies for the child. Some baby milk. Put them in the bottom of the pram. And walked out the door. On a train. And never went back.
Mandy escaped the abuse, but she couldn't escape the consequences. Her son was born with a genetic disability. Neither of us have ever talked to another mum with a child born from abuse. So this is a first for both of us.
Good girl. Hiya, good girl.
Do you think it's different for us as mums having a child conceived through abuse to having children conceived in a happy relationship?
Yeah.
How do you think it's different?
Before I had my other children, I thought I knew what loving a baby was.
Mm.
And then when I had... for children.
Mm.
It sounds awful to say that.
Mm.
I knew where it was. He wasn't conceived out of love.
Mm.
He was conceived by a monster. But by God, I love him. But yeah.
I always say I'm the survivor. My son's a victim because he is. He's, even though I carry it on in my head, everything that's wrong with him is because of what abuse. Happened to me. Because a crime happened to me.
Mm.
It happened to him as well.
And this is going to affect him for the rest of his life?
Yeah. I do his meals. I do his bathing. And he always says to people, she's my mum and she's my carer.
Oh, bless.
So, yeah. He's my son.
Yeah.
Always will be. But sometimes you go there and then sometimes, no, don't go there.
Mm.
People don't, you know, when they'd find out, they'd say, you're disgusting.
you had an affair with your dad. That's horrible. Like, how could you do all that? I didn't. I was 11.
Mm.
Maybe younger, but the first recollection I have, I was 11.
Was there ever anyone that said, this is not your fault?
No. No.
Has anybody even now, after all these years, not just as a child, but as an adult and even after, you know, him going to prison, has anybody ever said, this isn't your fault?
No.
Oh, I'm going to cry now. Well, I'm going to be the first. It's not your fault. And you're not to blame.
How many women are sat at home now in my position I was all them years ago, thinking, I'm going to be stuck here forever. And you're not. Open that door and get the hell out.
Feel a little bit lost for words. I mean, she's just been through so much, and I just think she's by far one of the bravest, if not the bravest people that I've ever met in my life. Everyone I've met has felt so alone, and there's nothing here to help people like us. I want to see how people elsewhere in the world have changed that. Rwanda is one of the only places in the world with specialist counselling for mothers and children born of rape.
It was a massacre that saw a tenth of the population killed.
This country suffered a genocide in 1994.
Women, children, they were hunted down and slaughtered.
800,000 people were massacred in just 100 days.
The killers were a mixture of regular forces and Hutu militias, who took to the streets with clubs and machetes. Their victims were the minority Tutsis and some moderate Hutus who stood against.
Rape were also a weapon of the genocide, and hundreds of thousands of mainly Tutsi women were raped.
Turi guhunga abangiragaho nago basa tero cyampumburaga mubiri wacu wanje wari ugikoresho cyabo ku mugaragaro ntago bahishaga umwe yavaga undi akajya undi akava undi akajya undi akava akajya niko cyasegaga kingaritse hari yakinyishe nabi.
Claire was thrown into a mass grave among the dead bodies. Somehow she lived. But her ordeal wasn't over. She realised she was pregnant by one of her attackers. Claire even thought about killing her baby when it were born. But when she saw her daughter's face for the first time, she knew she couldn't.
Hi, you must be Claire and Elizabeth. How are you? And you must be Elizabeth. Can I give you a hug as well?
Hi.
How are you?
Claire kept the truth hidden for years. It was only when she met other mothers like her that she opened up and told her daughter how she was born.
Ubwo rero kubyakira nabyakiye cyane mukunda cyane nibwo namukunze numvise ibyawe bimora ku mutima wari umwana mutoya. Yes, so am I. No, I quite not can a coco. You're what I can.
I was a baby. I'll go to the next.
What am I going to say?
He was my angel.
Chan. Chan, it was a little garagaro.
And that's him when he was a little bit older.
Kandi none kindi nagukundiye cyane nagukundiye ko twahuje n'ibibazo ubwo rero iyo wibonyemo nawe uri kumwe n'uwo muhoje ibibazo usanga utari utibonye wenyine usanga utari wenyine twarebye kumva wibereye mutoya
faze yihungabana ryagiye riva ku babyeyi riri kwataka abana uvuga ngo baracyakeneye no gufashwa psychologically bakeneye gufashwa nabo kuri ibyo bibazo kubera kutiyakira.
As many as 20,000 children were born from rape during the genocide against the Tutsi. Here they come together to talk about how it's affected them.
Ubundi nturi umuntu nk'abandi nubundi wowe uri muri bamwe nubundi bagiye batugirira nabi nkababazwa mbese mu buryo bwose bushoboka naraje muri aya matsinda ya small group baranteruye banyereka urukundo.
When I'm kind of sat there as a mom and you know I'm gonna get emotional so kind of like when I'm seeing it from a moment, I know what my son's feeling as well. That was like really difficult.
What happened here in 1994 is very different to what happened to me. But we still have so much in common. It's been incredible to see how children and mothers here dealt with their struggles by coming together. I just wish me and my son had not felt so alone. Things between me and my son have always been difficult. And I don't know what the future holds.
Go. Sit. Paw. Good girl.
I just wish that me and my son would have been able to process everything a lot better than what we did. But I'm his mum and I love him. I always will do, and he knows that. Since I've been back from Rwanda, I've just been thinking about, you know, everything I learnt there and the people that I met. And one thing that really stood out for me is, you know, how everybody in Rwanda came together through a charity and just how much it helped them. So today I've invited some of the people from the documentary to come together in Sheffield. And for some of us, it's going to be the first time that they've ever met, you know, somebody that's been through their situation. So today's a really big day for them.
Talking about this is always going to be painful, but it feels like this is a first step.
My son's birth father is my father. Obviously, it's not a lot of people I've told about. I think you're the second person. People said to me, oh, you will have to adopt him, you'll have to adopt him, you can't look after him, you know, it's going to be a constant reminder, constant, all the time. And I said, no, it's not. Well, my son. Yeah. It matters to me to do this because I've always been silent. Now I'm a woman, fully grown woman, who's got a gob on her, and she's willing to use it. My son looks like his dad, so.
Does
but
it?
That doesn't matter to me.
No.
He's still my boy, so.
Exactly.
Yeah.
He's yours. First thing I said to my birth mother when we met, I said, if I remind you of him for a second, walk away, you know, and I'll totally understand. My relationship with my birth mother is, we've started talking again. It's lovely. And I hope there's love there.
And now I'm getting emotional.
Don't start me again.
but honestly, well, every single one of you, honestly, you're I think you're incredible anyway.
You don't have to feel alone and confused and scared, because that's how I felt. And it's not that bad. You can feel a lot happier about this subject. You don't have to always feel so sad.
Not to be ashamed of, nothing to be ashamed of at all. Nobody can stop me.